clap goes to Billy Bremner and Leeds United.
I think it's a very sad day for Leeds. I think it's slightly sad for football.
This is an adventure, and I hope we can go a long way as an adventure.
We lived the dream. We enjoyed the dream.
I look on them all, every one of them in this club, as my own son.
Approaching the new millennium, a dynamic young Leeds team was mixing it with the best of English and European football, despite a number of off-field traumas.
Two young Leeds United and England footballers, Lee Bowyer and Jonathan Woodgate, were arrested today.
The crash has chilling similarities to the 1958 Munich air disaster.
The moment the knives came out in Istanbul, football became the loser.
I just wanted to change the style, make us an attractive team.
It's a wonderful period in the history of Leeds United from a football point of view.
We've come a long way. But we're not too Leeds had failed to build on their 1992 League Championship win.
We've had success, we've had good times, but remember this.
Eric Cantona had become an instant phenomenon, but just months after he lifted the trophy, he was controversially sold to Manchester United.
It's a football club. Some things happen and they're best kept in the club. All I can say is that it was not my decision to leave, it was his decision. And I was faced with a player who was sitting in France who said he was not going to come back and play at Leeds. So, as I've already said, I didn't have a choice. And obviously, those reasons I want to talk about, I've talked about, and those reasons I can't talk about, I won't.
It was a rumour that started about three different players' wives, and there was no truth in it whatsoever with any of the wives. I mean, Eric wasn't that sort of person. I roomed with Eric, and I think what happened was that the fans had to have a reason why he left, and it wasn't just the fact that him and Howard had basically fallen out. That you know, they couldn't accept that. As I said, there's no truth about the rumours regarding myself or any of the other players. Howard has to have people who toe the line, and Eric wasn't a good person out of the team. Great player when he's playing, but not when he's out of the team. It wasn't really a great team man.
Fantastic! What a man he is! There can't be many better goal scorers than this fellow.
They briefly dazzled in Europe, but by the mid-90s, Leeds were caught in a downward spiral.
Leadership at Leeds had started to fragment. The future of the club became uncertain because there were buyers out there in the market. Other people were mentioned as manager. The direction the club was moving in became uncertain, and that spread down through the club.
Nobody was settled, really. I mean, I was new at the club, and you know, I was trying to establish myself. You know, when things like that happen around the club, the club become destabilized, and you know, every player don't know what's going to happen next.
Wilkinson's Leeds did have the chance of more silverware in the 1996 League Cup final, but they lost 3-0 to Aston Villa.
The League Cup final was really, it heralded the beginning of the end. And to be quite honest with you, I started not to enjoy driving into work.
And a 4-0 hammering by Manchester United early the next season brought the curtain down.
It is with great regret that I announce today that Leeds United have parted company with their manager, Howard Wilkinson.
It was time to go. I knew the manager they wanted. And it certainly came at the wrong time as far as the youngsters were concerned, because we were 18 months from having a new team. We were 18 months from Woodgate, Smith, Kewell, Hart, MacPhail, Boyer. We were 18 months from them being ready to compete in the Premiership.
Any regrets at all after all these years?
Oh, look, you know, this is not the Parkinson show. I heard you say...
Wilkinson's replacement was the former Arsenal manager, George Graham.
I think he's one of the best managers I've ever had. Yes, we had a great relationship. I don't know if because of who we work together, he likes to work with the defenders a lot. But, you know, as a disciplinarian and straightforward and fair manager, I mean, that's what made me work hard. I think he brought the best out of me.
Joe's never really played many young players. I mean, he played Harry Kewell, you know, and Harry was probably the most outstanding of all the young players, you know, from the point of view of his physical strength and his pace. You know, George's reign at the club was reasonably successful, although people probably didn't enjoy watching him as much as some of the teams that have played since then. George liked players to play. It's funny when you get people like George, who was a, to me, was a flair player, and yeah, and he became a manager. He concentrated me on the other side of the game.
When George came in, there was the need to make sure we weren't going to get beaten. And, of course, that's what happened in George's first season. We didn't score a lot of goals, but we didn't let a lot of goals in either. So he built from the back. And, you know, George was a very experienced, a very good manager, and I think George was the right man at the right time for Leeds United.
Shortly after his appointment, Graham brought in a one-time Arsenal lieutenant as his right-hand man, David O'Leary.
They were a team when George took over that were heading for relegation in many ways. Club needed sorting out discipline-wise off the pitch, and it really needed steadying, and it was a hard, hard job, and George did a fantastic job on that. I sit and wait, there's an
angel, contemplate my fate. O'Leary was on board the team's charter flight, George Graham wasn't, on March the 30th, 1998, when time stood still for that Leeds United squad. Coming home from a midweek game at West Ham, the plane crash-landed at Stansted.
We just had a lucky night. You know, we could have taken off in that aircraft, and our family's all asleep in bed and probably told that we'd been killed. But we got lucky.
Because we managed to get out alive, people dismiss it as if it wasn't particularly a serious incident. I think anybody who reads the CAA report on it will see how serious it was, because if the pilot had done what he should have done, which was circle the airport to come back in again, the report said the plane would have exploded, we'd all be dead. And through it, oh,
she offers me protection. You just didn't know where you were going to end up. And lucky, after all the screeches and the whatever, we grind to a halt. The plane was on fire. There was a smell of diesel or whatever, you know, petrol or whatever, fuel from the tank. And you thought maybe you were not going to get out and it's going to blow up, but we did get out, and we're all fine, and you know, the grace of God, we're still here. I'm loving angels
instead. A final word, are you going to Tottenham or not?
I'll be there on Saturday, definitely.
Thank you.
Good luck. <line. laughs>
And after weeks of speculation in September 1998, George Graham did leave Leeds for Tottenham Hotspur.
We went to play Maritimo, I think, in Europe. The atmosphere out there wasn't great with the fans, and I think the board and George were, you know, I wasn't being informed, but looked to be arguing about things or arguing about him leaving.
We all ultimately knew that George wanted to go. It was a question of whether Tottenham were prepared to pay. and it was 2 days before the Madeira game that Alan Sugar and I agreed a deal, and the deal was that as long as he paid the amount of money stipulated in the contract and that it wasn't announced publicly till after that game in Madeira.
Out in Portugal, the pressure of keeping the secret was starting to get to Graham.
I'll speak about the game and I'll answer one question. Right, I'm not going to go on and on and on and on.
One question about the game, is that? Or one question plus?
No, I'm not pushing on, no. Is it?
I'm disappointed, most of all, for Leeds United Football Club, because clearly George had started to do a job which, in my opinion, he hasn't stayed to complete. And therefore, of course, I'm disappointed.
I've ruled myself out for personal reasons, and maybe someday I'll say why.
Initially, I'd come out and said I didn't want the job. Initially, because I thought the club wouldn't want me, and initially as well, I thought the fans wouldn't want me, that they'd want me to clear off back because George Graham brought you in.
I think it's an open secret that we tried to talk to Martin O'Neill. Clearly we were unsuccessful, but during that period, of course, David had an opportunity to take charge of the team. I think he enjoyed it, and the fans enjoyed what he was doing. The players certainly enjoyed it, and it was almost a natural conclusion that David took over the job. And it was the night when we played in Rome, against Roma, when David was in charge and the fans responding to him, and we realised actually we should stop the uncertainty and get the appointment made, and that's what we did.
Coming back from Rome, there's an announcement that Martin O'Neill is staying at Leicester, and getting off the plane at Leeds, the chairman said to me, "Where are you going now?" And I thought, something's up, I might have a chance of getting this job.
And went to David's house, and that was the most difficult thing. I thought he'd jump at it, and he said he wanted a few days to think about it, which I have to say caught me by surprise, because I thought he'd be very grateful for the job. And David said, "Well, you know, you've had a few weeks to think about it, I'll have a few days to think about it as well."
O'Leary thought about it, said yes, and one of the most eventful periods in Leeds United's history was about to unfold.
Leeds to another level then. I asked the club, they said they'd, he had a little bit of money to spend. They said I'd want to bring Batty back, and there's three or four kids I want to put into the team. And it'd be like giving an injection of about five new players, so we could do that. And I just wanted to change the style and make us an attractive team.
I felt there were certain players at the club that could play on the side, regardless of their age or their inexperience. I mean, because of I've seen it happen in other years, and if they're good enough, we'll put them in.
I know that David had been asking George for some time to start playing with Woody, for example, and he hadn't done. And David then took the gamble, and it was clear. I mean, Jonathan was, is one of the classiest centre-halves I've seen.
I think he learned a bit from George Graham, and at least he knew the setup then. Since he's been working with George, but I think he did take the club to another level.
By January 2000, Leeds were top of the Premiership and confirmed their status as a growing force in English football with a 5-2 FA Cup win at Manchester City. But that was the last time that David O'Leary's Leeds could concentrate solely on football. Before they could take to the field again, everything would change forever.
Two young Leeds United and England footballers, Lee Bowyer and Jonathan Woodgate, were arrested today over an assault on an Asian teenager in Leeds city centre last week.
You get a phone call. The phone call didn't suggest it was serious or the seriousness of it. And I wasn't quite sure what to do. I phoned David and said, should I fly straight back? And I don't think he understood the seriousness of it.
The first couple of years, it was a pleasure to manage Leeds, and we'd become everybody's favourite. And I think over that period, for all we kept qualifying for Europe and doing exceptional under the circumstances, that put us back a long way football-wise. and public relations wise that Peter Ridgedale and everybody worked so hard for.
Despite criminal proceedings hanging over Bowyer, Woodgate and another first team player, Michael Dewberry, Leeds reached the UEFA Cup semi-final.
Good luck, lads.
Their opponents were Turkish champions Galatasaray, and on April the 5th, 2000, Leeds United's players and fans flew out to Istanbul. English teams playing European ties in Turkey had always expected a rough reception, but this was different. On that fateful night, the eve of the match, two Leeds supporters were murdered.
No English lads had anything with them. No English lads had daggers, knives, scaffolding poles.
Apparently it's football violence and football hooligans. But there's two English are dead. Two Leeds are dead.
Two of our lads
there must
are
be
dead.
10 stabbed. How many Turks have...
These were guys that you knew personally as well, weren't they?
Yeah,
well, yeah. Lads that we've seen at football.
You see
week in, week out.
We were in the official dinner the night before the match, which is traditional in all the European games, and we got a call through to say there'd been an incident and that they thought that at least one of our supporters had died. I gave my apologies to the Galatasaray officials and said I want to go straight to hospital and suggested that the rest of our party get back to the hotel where we knew they were safe.
That was typical Peter. I think he handled himself so well in that period.
It was instinctive. I just thought we ought to be there, and at the end of the day, they were our supporters.
Hearing in the news about the two fans, you know, that shook us a bit. And, you know, we went to the game not fully concentrated.
Nobody had a stomach for playing a football match. I mean, you just have to look at the Turkish supporters. You just have to look at the way the players were treated by the police, the way all our fans were treated by the police that night. Nobody wanted to be there. It was the most intimidating experience I've ever witnessed in my life in a football ground, and I was sitting in the director's area. It was horrible.
You know, you come back to the second leg, and second leg had been, you'd been attending the two funerals the day before, and it wasn't talk about football, it was talk about deaths and violence and shocking.
Leeds had lost to Galatasaray, but the next season, despite the high-profile court case casting another shadow, they were enjoying victories against Europe's very best in a remarkable Champions League run.
You don't have to put that on, do you? Can't sing.
But it all began inauspiciously with a 4-0 hammering at Barcelona's Nou Camp Stadium.
I was in fear and not let it out to the players. I was very much in fear of what was going to happen because I remember watching them play in the afternoon. I said to myself, we're in trouble here in Wales. You know, you can't give that out to the players because I know they'll give their best, but this team could give us a right hiding on this big pitch with the amount of players we've got missing.
Look at the stars. It was an eye-opener for us. I mean, that was welcome to the Champions League. You know, then we knew that we're playing against the big boys.
There was a feeling that inferiority complex a bit. Was it down here like David and I sat with a player and I had to say if they wanted to be great players, this is the places they had to come and they had to be able to cope with it. And the pleasing thing for David and, you know, as manager of the club is that they learned very quickly for that game.
High points for so many, beating Besiktas at Ellen Road, I think was it 6, going to Milan and qualifying for the next group, which nobody expected us to come out. Seeing our wonderful fans, the way they enjoyed and celebrated.
We are Leeds, and we're there! Yes!
We're there!
I look back on them now and you say, well, you know, should I have been as visible as I was during that period? But it was a dream. I mean, you know, when we took over, certainly when I took over as chairman, nobody could have believed we were going to get through to the semi-final of the Champions League so quickly.
Play against the great teams in Europe, you know, great atmospheres at Elland Road, I mean, great football at the club, everybody enjoying it, and it was fantastic.
As they hurtled towards the Champions League semi-final, Leeds smashed the British transfer record with the £18 million signing of defender Rio Ferdinand.
I'm glad Peter didn't ask me, do you want to pay £18 million, because I think I might have bottled it.
When we agreed the deal, I didn't sleep from that day till Rio signing, because I realised the enormity of spending that sort of money on one player.
Ferdinand! 3-0 Leeds! Leeds are on top of their game, on top of the world, and looking at a European Cup semi-final.
David O'Leary's team was improving rapidly. His originality wasn't.
I'm enjoying this adventure. This is an adventure, and I hope we can go a long way as an adventure. And I really hope they enjoy this adventure. But this is all just a learning process.
We'll have a very, very young side out. We probably might have the youngest team ever to appear in Europe.
Look at the kids. I'm only a young manager that's done nothing.
I'm the baby of the Premier League.
I've done nothing as a manager.
I never thought as a manager, a young manager who's done nothing, really.
Young baby as a manager, I know he's a laugh at me. I am.
But you know the young naive thing? We said that like somebody to yourself in my first year as a throwaway bit of fun line, and nobody had let it go after that. You know, the people were saying, and I just said as a bit of fun to a friend in the press audience, but people wouldn't let it go from there, but it was said in a bit of fun, you know.
Next week on Leeds, 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 anything but fun.
I don't think anybody who wasn't intimately involved with Leeds United at the time can truly understand how much that took out of many of us at the club.
Where I got totally disgusted with them afterwards was the spin and the lack of class and how they tried to degrade you afterwards.
He said that, well, you didn't look very happy, he said, Peter, and I said, well, what do you want, a round of applause?